Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Costas, and I'm proud to present the 17th home video edition of the Authorized History of the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Review. It was 1944 in Stromboli, Italy. A young couple, Salvatore and Rosa Servidio, hear their first Howlin' Wolf song over Radio Free Europe. That fateful night, under the red moonlight in the town square, they decided to migrate to America to sing the blues. Arriving in one corner Mississippi, penniless, with only the clothes on their backs and the guitar and accordion they bought with a bag of beans and a sack of pastina, they struggled to make a living by farming during the day and playing the blues at night. In 1950, their first child, a masculine child, was born. Premature, small, and sickly, they named him John after their newfound friend, John Lee Hooker. In 1955, Salvatore, in his despair, took to drinking and what Rosa would later call rolling and rocking. Salvatore hit the road that year, leaving Rosa and John alone. For the next 2 years, Rosa scrubbed floors while John spent his days arranging his mother's pots and pans on the kitchen floor, banging away mindlessly until Rosa came home. In 1959, with Rosa now also in despair and seeing no future, she gave John her last $10, kissed him gently, and ran away with Boots Randolph. John took his two best pots and left for Chicago. Weeks later, walking the streets of the Windy City, penniless and now potless, he was befriended by Lightning Slim, who was playing at Sam's Alligator Pit on Dexeter Avenue. For the next 3 years, John, nicknamed Stromboli by that great blues artist Lonesome Sundown, ran errands and listened to the music.
Let me hear you say yeah!
Soon, Johnny was playing drums for the James Brown Revue at night and sleeping during the day, eating mashed potatoes with that special southern fried blues that was shaping him for his call to musical destiny.
Are you ready for the night train?
John went down to Melancholia, a club down by the rail yards, where he heard about a singer going by the name of Lisa Ma Smith.
Stop! Don't do it!
He got there as she was finishing up her third set, singing into a bottle of Jack Daniels. She had a voice like Bessie and a body like Lena. They realized that the only things that mattered to both of them was the blues, waking up in your clothes, bourbon, and BMWs. Picking up different gigs throughout the South and West, they traveled together for the next 6 months. One night in 60, after backing up Gatemouth Brown at the Atchafalaya River Club in Crowley, Louisiana, Stromboli and Ma heard of a skinny kid out of Memphis that was making some noise on the local scene at a new label called Sun Records. The next day, they packed their belongings and left for Memphis, where they would meet and play with Elvis on Hound Dog, along with a skinny blue-eyed kid playing lead guitar by the name of Brian Smooth Gallagher. Smooth, coming out of Colorado, was recently fired as the billboard model for a place called the Levi Strauss Company. He decided that the new scene called rockabilly coming out of the cities in the South was where he was going to find his fame and fortune. Smooth told them about his brother, Darren Dangerous Gallagher. Over the previous 2 years, Dangerous had been picked up for 3 armed robberies, 6 assaults, and had just finished a stint in the Biloxi House of Detention for kidnapping a disgruntled postal worker. The next day, filled with songs and dreams, Stromboli, Ma, and Smooth went down to some flop house called Harry's Hostel and found Dangerous. Together, they headed east for what would later be known in music history as the Mississippi meets the Mercy period.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Arriving in London in the summer of 62, Stromboli, Ma, Smooth, and Dangerous went to a club called The Cave, where they were invited up on stage to back up some kids who called themselves the Betelgeuses. Stromboli, liking the name of the band more than their sound, nonetheless found himself on stage filling in for the recently fired Pete Best. Later that night, Lennon came off the stage and asked Stromboli to join the group. Not with a name like the Betelgeuses, Stromboli said. Besides, I have bigger catfish to fry back in the States. A few minutes later, with Stromboli convincing Lennon to change the name to just The Beatles, Stromboli settled at the bar, where he got to know the guy who'd become the next member, Tommy the Killer Gallo. Tommy migrated from Union City, New Jersey 2 months earlier, looking to join up with Freddie and the Dreamers, and was ready to play some real music. With Killer, they stayed abroad for 5 years, making their first fortune and spending it just as quickly. In late 66, Stromboli had visions of the Revue conquering America the way they did Europe. One night, reminiscing about the good old days in Mississippi, Ma told Stromboli about her twin sister Shakalika, who had just had a big hit with some loser named Sonny in California. She changed her name to Sandy Like a Stone Scragg and was looking for a new group to play with. On Ma's urging, Stromboli called and told Like a Stone to look no further. The group, now formally called the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue, was coming back to the States. So the summer of 67 brought the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue straight to the Haight-Ashbury area, where they jammed with the likes of Hendrix, Big Brother, and Moby Grape. As you all know, this time in the Bay Area has been called one of the major turning points in the history of music. The Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue was about to meet the man who would change them into the most popular and successful band the world has ever known. The man who just last year was given the Life Achievement Award from both the Coca-Cola Bottlers of Pennsylvania and the Entenmann Cake Foundation. The man who's part owner with Joey Ramone in the House of Melancholia, which just opened its 14th club in Southwest Staten Island. The man who has a line of casual wear that this year won the prestigious award from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for what was described as the best line of clothes for those on the way back from oblivion. And last but not least, the man who is sole owner of Pasta and Fagioli Records, the most successful record company specializing in South American calypso blues for the last 10 years. You all know who. Carlo Jerry the G Magnum Gennarelli. It's what legends are made of. Jerry the G Magnum and Stromboli standing in front of Chubby's Fried Fish Pit down by the pier, drinking their last bottle of P&M whiskey, watching the moon go down over the Golden Gate, and planning out their campaign to conquer the music industry. So you want to be a rock and roll star, from there, the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue headlined at Woodstock in 69, where they picked up Gary the Dr. Woodruff, who was a roadie for Country Joe and the Fish. Although the doctor remembers nothing about the 5 days he spent at Woodstock, he was convinced by Stromboli that there really was a place called Woodstock, and that he really was there. To this day, he has flashbacks whenever he comes near a lake or a bowl of granola. The final member of the band came along in 78, at the height of disco. John, only 87, Keys, was found backing up Travolta on the little-known These Pointy Shoes Are Made to Point Up to the Sky With tour that closed one cold night in Schenectady after only 16 people showed up to hear him sing Jungle Boogie without a mic. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the story behind and about the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue. It's not a story about just a band. It's a story about where and why music is what it is today. After playing in front of over 150 million people over the last 40 years in over 60 countries, after the ups and the downs, the hits and the cancellations, it is now time to put that drink under your arm and your shoes under the chair and roll with the band who has just broken all records on their recently completed All the Way Down Route 80 tour. Here's Stromboli, Jerry the G Magnum, Ma, Smooth, Dangerous, Like a Stone, Killer, the Doctor, and only 87 Keys, now and forever, the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special bulletin.
Last night, here at the Limelight, sometime after the world-famous Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue were finishing up their last set, a person in silhouette was seen approaching the band's manager, Sam Domenico, alias Big Bucks, in a dressing room backstage. There was a shot. The body of Domenico fell. The lights went out. Moments later, police arrived, broke into the dressing room, and found it empty. The body was gone. I interviewed Sergeant McDuty, who told me that right now the prime suspects are the band members themselves. The motive? Sources tell me that last week Domenico refused to reimburse $12.98, money the band members had spent out of their own pockets for beer and pretzels at their last rehearsal. That's all I have right now, Tom. We'll, of course, keep you posted on further developments. I can tell you one thing. Not since the kidnap of the Lindbergh baby has this town been so caught up in a crime.
Good evening, Mr. Phelps. In front of you is the photograph of the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue. By now, you are well aware of the mysterious disappearance of their manager, Sam Domenico, alias Little Bucks. We now know that through the television connections of Betelgeuse Productions, which is really nothing more than a front for Domenico's money laundering schemes, the band members have melted into different parts of the entertainment industry, hoping not to be discovered. Your mission, if you choose to accept it, is to find the band members, uncover the true assailant, and bring back Domenico alive or dead. This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds. Good luck, Jim.
Lieutenant Colombo. What? Phelps? Jim? Mission him? Yes, yes, Mr. Phelps. You need help? Domenico disappearance. Right. What? TV. Yes, sir. I have a TV. Right. I'll help. That's correct, sir. Place to start, TV. By the way, how was my wife's sausage I sent over to you last week? A little bit of beef, a little bit of pork, a little bit of... Phelps? Gallo. Forget about it. It was nothing. All right, so, Phelps says they all took different identities. Place to start, TV.
And now, No Fat Cooking with Vinny the Gagoots.
Hello, everybody. My name, she's a Vinny the Gagoots. And this is No Fat Cooking with Vinny the Gagoots. Before we start, let me ask you three questions. Question number one, do you like to eat? We all like to eat. Do you like to cook? We all love to cook. Do you like the fat? Nobody likes the fat. It's like getting a gun. You stick it in your mouth, you blow your brains out all over. Today's recipe from my favorite Uncle...
Whoa, wait a minute. That's no Vinny the Gagoots. That's Stromboli.
Palermo's a beautiful city.
Palermo has a lot of hills. It has a duck, a lot of ducks. It has a fig tree. It has the olive tree. It has a pizza tree. I caught you, there's no pizza tree in Palermo. Today, here's the ingredients for duck a l'orange a la Gagoots. First, you get one whole duck, a lot of skin. You get a pound of German butter. You get a couple of oranges. You get a lot of lard, a lot of lard. You get the salt, you get the pepper, you get the cinnamon, you get the sugar, you get the 4 cups of olive oil, and you get special Chef Prudhomme's Louisiana hot sauce. We ready to go now? Here we go. You pick up the duck. You throw it in the garbage. You get the butter. And with the plate, you throw it in the garbage. You get the oranges, you throw it in the garbage. You get the lard. Throw that in the garbage. You get the sugar. In the garbage, the salt, the pepper. Garbage, the cinnamon, the hot, Prudhomme's special hot sauce. In the garbage. You get the oil. Throw that in the garbage. You know what you got left? You got one beautiful orange. You eat the orange. You get the water. You wash it down. There you got it. Duck a l'orange a la Gagoots.
Goodbye, everybody.
I knew it couldn't have been Stromboli. By the leg of the chair at the crime scene, a bucket of jerk chicken. Stromboli would never have eaten that. Cooked in butter. My wife, on the other hand, maybe.
Tonight at 9, the world premiere of Rambo vs. the Killer, Part 2. Has Rambo met his match? Will there be a Rambo 30? Will Killer strip Rambo of his power and rule the world?
Forget about it.
Watch tonight to learn the outcome of the Battle of the Century.
What is this big secret?
About 6 months ago, I woke up with this uncontrollable urge for mangoes, jalapenos, and Ricky Ricardo records. I find myself daydreaming of tropical fruit and suddenly, without warning, breaking into song.
Brasil, esse coqueiro que dá coco, foi onde amar minha rede.
Last week, after one too many margaritas, I woke up in the bottom of the garbage bin outside Victor's Cafe with two half-eaten chicken quesadillas in my hand. My children are embarrassed when I come to school to pick them up dressed like this. Their friends even call me fruitcake. I'm at the end of my rope. I need help, please.
Like a stone. She looks more like a fruit now.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight on America's Most Dangerous, we stray from our usual format to bring you a story that is so bizarre that we are devoting a full hour to one subject. Take away the pierced nose, the eye patch, the scar across his right cheek and his bald head, add a mustache and a beard, and there is the famed bass player from the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue, Dangerous. He spent this past year hiding to avoid arrest and a possible execution. After that fateful night at the Limelight, Dangerous did what no other man or woman has ever done. He broke into prison. For the past year, Dangerous has occupied cell number R16 at Attica under the alias of Fightin' Bill Leary.
Spending his days cracking crabs for Mrs. Paul's fish sticks and his nights plotting his next break-in, Dangerous has outwitted the police and the FBI for almost a year.
They'll never get me.
Now I know it couldn't have been that fella, Dangerous. At the crime scene was a half-drunk glass of a banana daiquiri. Everyone knows that Dangerous had a deathly fear of bananas during his first incarceration, when he was next to a deranged inmate who thought he was Jimmy Durante, who was constantly groaning, "Yes, we have no bananas."
We have no bananas.
Tonight, an exclusive from Hard Copy. Senator Al D'Amato is under Senate indictment for behavior unbecoming a public figure because of his secret love nest in Manhattan. Last night, after an anonymous tip, the police broke down the doors to his den of iniquity and found the senator in bed with his longtime mistress, Sister Nyree. In a statement issued earlier today, the senator denied all accusations. He said he was framed and that the only sister he ever knew was a Sister Angelique, a member of the feared Sisters of Perpetual Pain.
Sister Nyree. Sister Nyree, tell us about Big Al.
Well, I met Al outside the limelight like a year ago, and he picked me up outside with his limo. He's been taking care of me ever since, taking care of me real good. But I'm glad we got caught. I don't believe he lied and said he didn't know me. As a matter of fact, you know what? As a matter of fact, I want America to know Al is no good in bed. He's lacking, and he's just absolutely no good. And besides, I was tired of him calling me Angelique all the time. Always wanted me to wear some habit. You're gonna learn my name, Al. You're gonna learn my name.
Tonight at 10, Ben tells little Joe, Hoss, and Adam the truth about their half-brother, Hans Cartwright. Hans, conceived during one of Pa's long, lonely cattle drives through the Black Forest, comes to the Ponderosa to make peace with himself and his true family by composing the now famous Bonanza theme on his newfangled electronic sousaphone. Tonight at 10.
I know it. There was no way it could have been only 87 keys. See the straw hat on the doorknob? Only 87 keys hate straw hats. As a kid, he always had nightmares that the Scarecrow from The Wizard of Oz turns out to be Liberace in disguise.
From his humble beginnings in One Boot, Arkansas, to his climb up the ladder of country stars, Bootsy has always kept three things close to his heart: his love for his mom, fried chitlins, and his music of lost love on the road. Here for the first time is Bootsy's greatest hits.
I love your smile, but those teeth have got to go. If you want me to love you, stop acting like a hoe. Well, this truck ain't big enough for the both of us. Well, the two of us just won't fit.
Bootsy just can't stop pouring out those hits.
Hey, mommy, you sold those socks yet? I really got to go. If you don't do your mending, I can't ride in the rodeo.
And now, for the first time ever, if you order Bootsy's Greatest Hits, we'll also send you this rare recording of Bootsy and Hank Williams Jr. singing, "What's This Doing on My Shoe?"
Son of a gun. That's no cowboy. That's the Soul Man.
Order today and get Bootsy's Greatest Hits and the rare recording with Hank Williams Jr., all for the low price of $19.99 for CD and $12.99 for 8-track.
That's $19.95 for CD, $12.99 for 8-track.
Call today.
There on the floor, see the CD case on the floor? Barry Manilow live from the Goats Arena in Aruba. Jerry the G Magnum would never have been caught dead near a Barry Manilow CD, period.
Coming up tonight, you've experienced all the other Bonds, but tonight, meet the Bond that out-bonds them all. Meet Junk Bond.
Bond. Junk Bond. 00007.
Experience the sophisticated but dangerous charm of Spectre's newest agent, the beautiful but carnivorous Russian spy. Can't touch this, Katerina.
Don't touch that, can't touch this.
Don't touch what?
Touch that.
You mean can't touch this?
Touch what?
Touch that?
No, touch this.
From deep in the bowels of Transylvania comes the most hideous vampire of them all. See Basil Lugosi in Vampire Maitre D'.
Table for two?
Screech as he performs his hideous lounge act.
This is for you, table number seven.
Feelings. Nothing more than feelings.
There is no escaping his evil plan.
Would you like a drink? A Bloody Mary, perhaps.
So there we have it. I found them all hiding in plain sight on television. Now, you gotta ask yourself, why would the band take on these high-profile characters if they really didn't want to be found? Because they did not commit the crimes. But they know who did. If you take all the characters' names and arrange them in the right order, an ingenious secret code starts to take shape. Basil, Bootsy, Kant, Hans, Nyree, Miranda, Larry, Gagoots, Keller, Bond. Take the fourth letter in each name, and there you have the band's desperate message. Look at it. It's Harold! The Jerk Chicken, the Banana Daiquiri, the Straw Hat, the Barry Manilow live from the Goats Arena in Aruba CD. All of these clues lead to only one man. Sam's long-lost, illegitimate twin, Harold Doo-Wop Domenico.
I didn't do it!
20 years ago, Harold's and Sam's daddy, Colonel Cornelius Domenico, bequeathed to Harold all of his earthly possessions, including the jewel of his empire, Betelgeuse Productions. Sam, unbeknownst to Harold, rewrote their father's will, cutting Harold out of everything. Depressed over the betrayal, Harold took to drinking tequila and eating poppy seed bagels in the Caribbean for the next 20 years. Last year, with the limelight, Harold found Sam Domenico, alias Notip, in the dressing room and handed him the original will signed by their daddy, Colonel Cornelius, 20 years earlier.
Where did you get this? In the drawer with daddy's underwear, you wretched thief!
Sam grabbed a 25 caliber he always carried and shot, but missed. In their frantic scuffle, they fought like animals. Harold knocked Sam unconscious. For the last year, Harold has kept Sam prisoner in the seldom-visited multimedia department waiting for his chance to be vindicated. Just last night, when Harold was enjoying his last bottle of two-worm mezcal with a tongue and Swiss cheese sandwich, Sam saw his chance to flee using the seldom-used Houdini wiggle technique. Once overcoming Harold, Sam fled into the night crying out his story. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the true story of the Domenico disappearance. One of the toughest cases I've ever cracked. I was thinking, one good thing did come out of this past year. Tonight, on this stage, cleared of all charges, you are about to see the reunion of the greatest rock and roll band ever to hit this side of Lake Ronkonkoma. Here are Stromboli, Jerry the G Magnum, Smooth, Dangerous, Like a Stone, Can't Touch This, Billy Bob Bob, Big Baby Browns with an S, Killer, and Only 87 Keys. Ladies and gentlemen, the Betelgeuse Rock and Soul Revue.